Desperate Irishmen came to the United States seeking a better life. They desired freedom from the poverty and disease plaguing their homeland. Instead, following their arrival, they endured back-breaking labor and ultimately murder. This is the tragic story of the 57 Irish railroad workers in the year 1832. Their journey began in Londonderry, Ireland, a failing city devoid of opportunities for Catholics to succeed in a Protestant-ruled country. The port city was crowded with many ambitious youths trying to escape to a promised place of freedom and opportunity in America. These men were offered that opportunity by Philip Duffy, a local contractor for the Philadelphia and Columbia Railroad. The P&C Railroad included a very important track line that connected Philadelphia and New York. This connection was essential to the modernization of America. To support the burgeoning American railroad industry and its expanding reach, network rail lines relied on hard physical labor to clear the paths, often through the mountains, without regular use of dynamite. Prior to constructing the significant railway connection with Philadelphia to New York, trade and military travel proved extremely difficult. The heavy forest and rough mountainous terrain prevented such transport, and likewise made rail construction almost unthinkable. One may contend that the P&C Railroad remains one of the biggest advancements for American growth, as the second largest track in all of North America, stretching 82 miles. This giant track was largely completed from the sweat and blood of Irish Catholic immigrants. As construction progressed, the workers encountered a problem. Mile 59, located in the wilderness of southeast Pennsylvania, was so difficult to clear, even slave owners would not dare risk their slaves' lives to build this track. Instead, 57 rugged, poor, desperate Irishmen looking for work in America showed up to do the job. Because the locals would not work for as little as the Irishmen, the railroad mostly hired Irish Catholic immigrants. To the Irish, anything was better than the poverty and disappointment they experienced in their homeland. Perhaps because of their desperation, the Irish laborers worked only for whiskey and 25 cents a day. For 6 long and painful summer weeks, the men worked through cruel weather conditions, including temperatures up to 100 degrees. Meanwhile, across the world, unsettling cholera epidemics swept over cities. Cholera is a water-based disease whose victims suffer from severe dehydration. In Europe alone, there were hundreds of thousands of deaths, and because of the boom in immigration from Europe to America at the time, sickness was being brought over in boatloads. As outbreaks began to occur in America, many locals became afraid of contact with the immigrants. When the locals found out that these workers might be infected, instead of getting them help, they quarantined Duffy's men from the rest of Chester County. The only people caring enough to help, putting their prejudices aside, were a local blacksmith and the Sisters of Charity, a small order of nuns in the Chester County area. The documents of the P&C Railroad recorded that all 57 of the men had died of cholera. The Irishmen at Duffy's Cut made crucial contributions to construct the railway, and yet, following their tragic deaths, they were all but forgotten. Half a century later, in the 1870s, Martin Clement, who was in charge of railroad expansion, heard the story of Duffy's Cut from Bridget Doyle, whose brother found the bodies under the track. When Martin Clement found out about this, he became so interested in the demise of the workers that he created the first documents recording the event. These few documents would later be critical for the groundbreaking excavation investigating Duffy's Cut that would occur 130 years later in 2002. Following the sale of the P&C Railroad, the executive assistant to Clement, grandfather of Duffy's Cut experts William and Frank Watson, swiped the documents as the P&C Railroad was being sold. Fascinated by the legend, he told the tale of Duffy's Cut to his young grandsons. Little did he know that by telling these, he helped uncover one of Philadelphia's largest mass murders.
Many years later, Frank Watson, while sorting through his late grandfather's documents, found what seemed to be evidence of mass death by cholera. He showed this to his brother, William. They suspected something shifty had happened because their late grandfather's documents did not match up with newspaper accounts and common knowledge of the incident. As they dug deeper, they found that Philip Duffy had worked very strenuously to hide the existence of the workers, leaving them to ask questions like, what was it that actually happened in that summer? This question is what drove them and several others to start the excavation of Mile 59 to try and solve the 167-year-old mystery. For years, they searched and searched, finding only artifacts, including things like rare pewter buttons, a Barlow knife, stone spikes, a Morris and Essex track piece, and pipes with the Erin Go Bragh flag on it, which was the first example of Irish nationalism found in North America. Finally, after years of searching in the same excruciating heat that the Irishmen had to work through, the team found their very first remains. In 2009, they discovered an 18-year-old man, John Ruddy. He was 5'6", but very strong, which was part of the appeal for having young Irish workers. What was so unique about these particular remains was the rare genetic effect found of not growing a top right molar, which helped identify him and his family who shared the anomaly. But probably the most shocking discovery was the evidence of murder found in the skulls. The team found things from blunt force trauma to bullet holes, leaving them to soon come to the conclusion that there was something much more sinister at play.
I know, okay? So this made all of us, you know, basically say, okay, this guy might have had cholera, but somebody hit him on the head. Probably killed him. That's a really serious fracture.
Once it was clear a massacre had taken place, all that was left to ask was why. Why would anyone do anything so extreme? Why would Duffy try to hide it? The investigators are still searching, but for the time being, the team has come up with the most reasonable answers. Presumably, the men were killed from fear of catching cholera, along with Irish Catholic prejudice that was so prominent in American society at the time. There are theories that Philip Duffy himself hired vigilantes to kill the men. Frank Watson is quoted to say, "We really have no evidence that Philip Duffy encouraged the vigilante violence, but it went beyond that. Philip Duffy never told the story of what really happened at Duffy's Cut, and until he died in 1871, it is very telling that no one else publicly told the story either. Duffy was a powerful man, he was politically connected, and no one was free to tell the story of what happened to the Irishman at Duffy's Cut until after Duffy died."
He exploited them, you know, to the degree that their story was forgotten. He didn't kill them, but he didn't do anything to completely preserve the story or even inform their relatives, you know, that this had even happened.
57 Irishmen accomplished constructing the critical Duffy's Cut, receiving not honor for their efforts, but murder. Duffy's 57 men are one story of many yet to be told of Irish immigration and contribution to the nation. These lost sons of Ireland helped build America's future. The team of archaeologists and historians continue their work to discover what truly happened. With every new piece of evidence uncovered, they unearth more of the triumph and the tragedy of the 57 men of Duffy's Cut.